text, this story that the lectionary, that is the readings that the church gives us, provide for us today, then we have to dig a bit deep, scratch the surface, and understand some of the background to it all. Now, this particular passage comes in the midst of a section of St. Mark's Gospel, which is sometimes called the bread section. Because over a period of time, the word bread is used 17 times. And in part, it's not only about eating, but touches on one of the themes in St. John's Gospel, where Jesus says, "I am the bread of life." So whenever there's a reference to the sort of eating of bread, we are to think beyond, as it were, bread to him. And of course, the purifying gift that comes when you allow Christ to enter your life. And actually, in the text, where in the translation, when the Pharisees are criticizing the disciples of Jesus, it says when they eat. Actually, in the original language, it's when they eat bread. And Mark uses exactly the same phrase in the original language as is used on the mountainside when a few verses before, 5,000 people have eaten bread. And you know they've done it without washing their hands. 5,000 of them. And maybe it is the knowledge of this sort of action, this breaking of ritual rules, that actually draws the Pharisees and the scribes from Jerusalem to come out into the countryside to face Jesus and to question him and to challenge him. So we're not just talking about 12 disciples who regularly eat food without washing their hands. This is not primarily, by the way, about hygiene, but about rituals and cleanliness before God. There's 5,000 of them, all good Jews, who are no longer obeying the rules. Because Jesus is providing them with opportunities to break the rules. Or rather, he is saying, there is a different way to holiness. And external forms. Now, Jesus is not questioning rituals in themselves. He shared in them. He actually made one up, which is the heart of the life of the church. Ritual actions, outward forms which convey deeper realities. What he is talking about is when there is a great chasm distance between the idea of clean hands and hearts. When you have clean hands but a distant heart. That's what he's talking about. When there is a sort of disconnect between what we do outwardly, and especially in our religion, in our rituals, and what is going on in our inner self. I find this a great challenge. The word Jesus uses to describe this sort of behavior is the word hypocrite. Now, the word originally, in the Greek understanding, the word hypocrite actually comes from the word from acting. So if you've ever acted, played a part, that's where the word comes from. In other words, you have a part to play, and you detach yourself from it, and it's not really you. You're sort of acting. On my shelves, in my study, somewhere tucked into one of the books there is a postcard. And it was sent to me the first time I led what was called a parish mission in England. Well, I went into a parish with a team of people, a few nuns, a few students of theology, a couple of priests, and we spent a week or 10 days in that parish, preaching, teaching, and so forth. And I was the main leader of the mission, so every night for 5 nights there was a preaching service, You think my sermons here are long? You have seen nothing till those missions. So much so that halfway through the sermon, the talk, I say, oh, let's sing a hymn to liven us up. And halfway through, there'd be a hymn, and then we'd get on with the rest of the preaching, and on it would go. They were, well, from my point of view, great days, interesting days. This was in the parish of Seaford on the coast of Sussex. And I can see myself now standing on the back of a lorry outside of a large department food store saying, the food in there will rot, but what I've got to offer will last forever. I mean, the hypocrisy was that later in the evening I had a meal that we bought from the same. There we are, that's the. Anyway, the card, the postcard in this book in my study, to get to the point, was written by my old spiritual director, who was himself a mission preacher, a great preacher. And on that postcard, in spindly writing, which I received the day before I went to the mission parish, were the words from the acting world, as you tread the boards, be assured of prayer. As you tread the boards. Was I just being like the Pharisees? I don't believe so, actually. There's a different thing between the detachment of cleaning your hands and a distant heart from the genuine spiritual struggle of trying to make the match between what we are experiencing in our very worship today and where my heart is at any given time or another. Jesus is not condemning the Pharisees who are struggling earnestly to develop a consistency of life, which is at the heart of a faithful life, whether it's to another person or to God. Consistency. A disciplined life. The life of a disciple. Nor is he condemning those who are seeking to make sense of the changes and chances of daily living. Nor is he condemning me for the times when I am more aware of the divine absence than the divine presence. Those times when God seems far away. Or even those times when I walk through that door and hopefully no one has known because I'm treading the boards. And the last place my heart at that moment wants to be is here. Well, not the last place, but you know. And I don't suppose every time you walk through that door, your heart has always skipped a beat with longing. But you're here. Jesus is not talking about that chasm, which is just part of the spiritual life. Just part. This was revealed fairly recently in the life of Teresa of Calcutta, whose feast day is actually this week. For after her death, it was revealed that for many, many years, she did what she did, even though she felt the absence rather than the presence of God in her life. That's heroic, not hypocritical. This is not what Jesus is talking about. That is a noble struggle. Indeed, without that struggle, I doubt there can be any faithfulness. Now, Jesus is talking about the sort of parading of self, the outward form, rather than inner reality. Of self-aggrandizement, which he perceived in those who walked around in broad phylacteries. It is a danger. This is the Jesus who discerned painfully for his own, in his own self, the sort of lack of humility. There was the law, and there were these extra rules which were originally designed to help you keep the law, but became an end in themselves. It would be like saying that Jesus has given us the Eucharist to share in, getting so caught up in the sort of rituals that surround it, which are supposed to make our heart disposed to him and ready to receive the mystery of his presence, and get so bogged down with them that they become more important than the beautiful moment when, with your brothers and sisters, you will receive into yourself the mysterious presence of Christ. The rules and regulations which are supposed to serve, wise rules, wise rituals, godly rituals, become an end in themselves. This is what Jesus is challenging. And actually, when those rules and rituals and actions become inappropriately depended on as making one virtuous, or rather making one right before God, then they indeed become dangerous. Most of us would think it absurd, even unkind, when they said to Jesus, "They've got no food." And he says, "Well, I'm not providing anything. They haven't washed their hands." Jesus peers gently but persistently into the heart and rejoices and strengthens the person who longs to be at one with him, and whose participation, dogged sometimes participation, sometimes seeming to receive nothing from the participation, still persist and keep on. Jesus delights in that life. What he will not delight in is hypocritical action. Clean hands, but distant heart. I will not condemn it. These brothers and sisters whom Jesus speaks harshly to, because of the moments in my own life when I have allowed clean hands and a distant heart in myself. But I can never approve of myself in those moments. And I pray for grace. Grace, so that which I enact with you.